Welcome back. Short break, little one there. Game number two between Execration and TNC is coming up right here, right now. I'm Durka in the JD Studios, and the draft is already underway, as you can hear. The lovely lady announcer, Dire Team Ban, actually, going to be coming up here. Gyro Bane up against the Beastmaster AA. Bans out Earth Spirit. Execration just been perma-banning that hero out non-stop against IG, against TNC. Don't care. Don't want to play against Earth Spirit. That's what their motto is so far. Now, my co-caster, Heen. Last game was a little bit slow-paced, but TNC, I think, are going to be ramping things up this game. It's one of their lovely combos where they just go around killing people. Beastmaster Roar, AA Ice Blast. They like to run the Queen of Pain with this a lot, but I can see Execration banning that out in this phase.
Yeah, I kind of reflected on what happened last game in terms of the draft, and I realized that neither team really... in the beginning, in the first phase, when they both picked two heroes, it looked like both teams were going to have Radiant an aggressive draft, but like, for example, TNC, I think their most aggressive support duo was like Disruptor or Shaker, but instead they had like an Undying Silencer, which, as we saw, couldn't really make stuff happen. And for Execration, they had Witch Doctor Bane, not the worst heroes to like, you know, make them commit, but they had a Silencer, which kind of countered both of them. So I guess like they didn't really intend for the game to go so stale, but like after the cards were dealt, they kind of like were like, oh, we forgot to pick stuns.
So, 10 seconds. So it's Silencer's fault.
Yeah.
Just blame Silencer. That's it. So Silencer ruined Bane and Witch Doctor, and Silencer was a kind of a static support on the other team. It's all down to that one hero.
So Execration. It's their turn to try out the gyrocopter, and TNC, I was watching, and they didn't pick for a very long time, or not a very long time, but they had, like, I could tell, like, AU was kind of contemplating, often, like, when you're second pick, you try Radiant to pick team the pairs together, and he, like, picked Beastmaster and AA almost simultaneously. So the idea, I think, is very, it's very transparent. You have a BKB piercing initiation in the form of Beastmaster, and then you have the AA follow-up, so like, even if Execration were to pick Dazzle, if TNC wants you dead, they're going to kill you.
I'm kind of surprised Execration don't ban the Queen of Pain. TNC love Queen of Pain for Sam Radiant H on the offlane. There we go. Like, this is their strat. They've run this a million times before with Beastmaster, AA, Queen of Pain. It's the mobility of Quap. It's the fact that you can pair up multiple heroes with the AA. It's kind of like the old Chinese strat where you had Clock, AA, Quap. And you'd have the long-range catch of Clock Hook into Ice Blast, and then Queen of Pain follows through with, like, Sonic Wave Scream. It's just insta-kill. Insta-kill on someone, get the numbers advantage, then you follow Radiant through and push into towers with Beastmaster having his boars up.
Do you happen to know who usually plays the Beastmaster on TNC?
I'm unsure. Because last time I saw them play this was, like, one of their strats at the start of the year. Sort of March, April kind of time. Around the same time as this was like the plan B. There was the Drow strat, and then there's this strat, where sometimes they had the Undying thrown in there as well. But I think it was Noji that used to play the Beastmaster back then, but I can't quite remember. It might be Sam H, even though Queen of Pain is like one of his heroes. They could always swap that onto. Yeah. The thing is with their team, they're so dynamic with their role attribution.
Yeah, they do really pick unconventional heroes, but one mental note I made to myself when I was preparing for TI was that this team, even when Queen of Pain was really popular as a mid-hero, Teehee didn't really play this hero much.
No, not at all.
It was Sam H, I think, played Queen of Pain the most in their roster, followed by Noji back then. So... maybe Execration thought the Beastmaster was going to be Sam H's offlane hero, so there was a, like, they could still pick the Queen of Pain, but they, like, knowing TNC's, like, past drafting history, they kind of, like, ruled it out. But I'm interested to see how they're gonna do the lanes. I've seen some, like, in OG No Tail runs the carry Beastmaster,
or even the Beastmaster mid. Like, Teehee loves his melee heroes mid.
Good, enjoys, like, pulling the creep aggro and making lanes that seem unfavorable to him actually pretty favorable, because Like the Beastmaster, he starts with like 60 something damage or something ridiculously high, so
Yeah.
he's actually a really strong mid laner.
It got buffed in the last patch as well. It went from like 63 to 68 or something. It's crazy. Maybe not that high, but it's a hell of a lot of damage, definitely.
Radiant team ban.
Wish there was a way to see before the game starts, but we'll find out. So the Abaddon, great pick against the Bane. It doesn't work against Glimpse, does it? Like you can't shield off
No, you
Glimpse, but you
can't.
can shield off
You
Fiend's Grip and Nightmare.
can you can shield off the
Ten
two Bane
seconds
spells.
remaining.
You can take off the Thunder Strike, which is really nice.
Five
So
seconds remaining.
like when people are going out of fog, you shield your ally and Disruptor was going to Glimpse and suddenly he loses
Dire
vision.
team ban.
Right now I don't think TNC has very good heroes against the Darkseer that just came out from Execration. AA is generally kind of difficult to play against Darkseer. Darkseer enjoy like even against a
Ten
tri-lane,
seconds
the
remaining.
tri-lane has to be ran pretty tight.
Five seconds remaining.
I don't think AA like they don't have they already
Reserve
have the two
time.
support heroes, which I think are the AA Abaddon that don't really threaten the Darkseer. So I'm wondering how they're going to lane this, or if they're going to put their off laner against a Darkseer solo. But at the same time, Execration has like a really strong tri lane potentially with the first three heroes picked.
Difficult decision now for Execration. So if we look at this, so the way I think it's going to go, Beastmaster mid, Queen of Pain off lane, yeah, it's going to be like a one roll hero
Radiant
that can
team
just
pick.
run at you constantly for TNC. So the Viper's a decent ban out. Abaddon AA. Again, we look at this and there's one stun. There is one stun and it's a Beastmaster roar. I would really, really love TNC to pick up, I don't know, a Wraith King, just a carry hero
Yeah.
that can get into the middle of the fight and has some kind of disable.
Yeah, generally I like when I was
10 seconds
drafting too, like
remaining.
I try to stick to the rule where you have like two clear fours of
Five
initiation.
seconds
Because if you
remaining.
only have one, oh, they picked the Juggernaut.
Dire
I
team
mean, Juggernaut
pick.
is like semi initiator because like he moves around so damn fast and like he's gonna Omni Slash people and people are gonna come try to help the guy. But if you only like in this game, if TNC have to rely only on the Beastmaster, it's kind of easy to keep track of one hero as opposed to like two heroes, for example, with Blink. So I hope we don't
10 seconds
see a repeat
remaining.
of last game, the kind of game where I think both
Five
teams were
seconds remaining.
pretty strong, but neither side really had the tools to
Reserve
open
time.
proper team fights.
Well, Execration, what's your plan? Mid hero remaining. You're
Ten
pretty sure now
seconds
you're going to be against the
remaining.
Beastmaster, I think. What do you look
Five
towards?
seconds
There's
remaining.
a Razor. There's a Lina. Okay. A little more magic damage. Now, Lina gives you a lot of burst, but you need to get that Yule Scepter a little bit faster. Oh, okay. So it's going to be. Oh, hang on a second. Teehee Juggernaut mid.
Does Juggernaut do okay against Lina?
Does that's the
I'm
wrong qu I honestly I think that's the wrong question. Does Teehee do well does Teehee do well against Shanks mid? Because honestly I've like you said, I've seen Teehee turn completely unfavorable lanes into lanes he just
Prepare
wins
for
that
battle.
way.
Look at the Juggernaut's item build. He bought the Iron Talon thing.
Oh, interesting. Whoa, interesting. See, then I take it back. Usually he goes like poor man shield.
Yeah, I think that's the most standard opening for melee mids.
But then you look at Queen of Pain, and she's got side lane items. I'm really confused.
Well, I think Raven's in the safe lane. That's a common starting item for the safe lane, so you can buy the finish on the null on the side shop.
You can't anymore. They
Oh, can you not?
moved Mantle of Intelligence out of the side shop.
Oh, patch
30
notes, I
seconds to
Yeah.
battle.
I
They
mean, the Beastmaster has boost, so I'm assuming he wants to go off lane. He wouldn't buy boost if he was gonna one-on-one the Darkseer.
Oh, Raven's gonna be so upset when he realizes this. It's one of those like small changes that maybe you don't like notice, or it doesn't click, or you know, jump out at you when you read the patch notes. But what else was changed? They added bottle, and they added vitality booster. You can buy the full Vanguard in the side shop, and they removed ultimate orb and mantle. I'll take that as tribute. So they kept the same number of items in the shop, but they just swapped a couple out. Well, poor Raven, poor Queen of Pain. No early null for you. Now
I'm most interested in seeing why the Juggernaut bought the Iron Talon.
Yeah. I'm going to come back to this now. I'm just going to watch mid lane. What is the reason behind this? I mean, let's just go over this. It's a brand new item. So targets a non-player enemy unit to remove 40% of its current HP. Now, when we first saw this, we thought, okay, junglers going to be great with this. You just go into a jungle camp, you take, you know, 40% HP off a centaur or an ogre or something. There. Down to low HP.
You got level 1 crit.
What?
Does he have no intention of laning? It's like some kind of pocket strat where the support AU lanes mid, because he has two branches. He's rushing bottle, I think, on Abaddon. He has 600 gold.
Something worth noting is AU loves his bottle rushes on things like Earthshaker, and he does play. He used to play core role for TNC. Like, he plays, if they want to pick Meepo, he's their Meepo player. He is a very, very good core player. I'm just really lost.
Meanwhile, forced out a TP from Darkseer, so he has to walk all the way back to this lane.
Oh, poor little guy. So Undying mid is just leeching experience against the dual lane mid of Bane Lina, while Juggernaut farms jungle. Wait,
well, I mean, like,
is the Iron Talon current HP? Okay, if it was max HP, that'd be ridiculous, I guess. Still pretty damn good.
So it's like really good for big camps, I guess. Oh, he got 2 points of healing wood.
He's level 3.
Really, I mean, like, it's pretty fast, but I guess he really doesn't want to ferry more. Region, he wants to get that boots. I think that's what he's going for. He's actually, he has more XP than the Lina, even though, I mean, like, the Bane did kind of steal a full level's worth of the XP. Meanwhile, Beastmaster, I think, he's doing okay at top. This lane is really tough for Beastmaster. Oh, that was unfortunate. Disruptor tried to unpull the Radiant creeps from going into this hard camp, but slightly late.
Teehee hasn't bought anything yet. 550 gold and counting. Well, okay. So semi jungle juggernaut. Oh, he wanted to go large camp, but it's been blocked up by a dire sentry. Okay, he's not gonna get that. And he knows Bane is roaming around.
Bane realizes what's happening, and he just blocked the other hard camp.
Okay. Okay. They're controlling things a little bit better now. So Execration, they've got a grasp on what's happening. Jugger has reached level 3, getting closer to level 4. It's just Abaddon at the mid lane. What's the plan?
I mean, I don't think Abaddon's at mid, other than the reason that they don't want to have a zero person lane. Abaddon doesn't really do anything against Lina. It's not like Lina's a type of hero like Queen of Pain that uses Shadow Strike and he can dispel it off. It's just pure damage. So.
Apparently, according to Scant, a guy that has watched a lot of TNC games and cast a lot of TNC games with me, they've apparently done this kind of thing before, where Teehee jungles with like a Storm Spirit and AU plays AA, and AA just sits mid to try and get levels. So they've done the same concept before, but I feel this is like next leveling it. Just the fact that with the Iron Talon, you can just go into the jungle and be that more efficient with a hero like Juggernaut. Without even leveling Spin. Like, he's got the first level of Spin at level 4. Invis Rune for Darkseer, running himself over, maybe try and leech some experience away from this.
He knows the Darkseer is probably around because he saw the Darkseer get the Invis Rune.
He also knows that he's losing experience on these camps as well. The creeps are not giving him enough. You'll know this. So stacks are being made up for the Lina. Actually, Lina's making her own stack. Shanks there. Get plenty of gold from that one. As Bane is waiting around at middle lane, but there's no catch. There's no way to actually stop him from moving around or actually kill him off. AU is just throwing out these miscoils. Level 2 miscoil, actually. No points in the curse.
Oh, the Darkseer got scouted. The range creep reacted to him. It was way too close to the tower.
Just surge himself away. So
the Darkseer just wasted way too much time. I understand that, like, he has an inventory room, but, like, the creep wave was pushing in. And now, like, he can't go back to his lane. And it was against a dual lane, too. Like I mentioned, I don't think AA is a very good support against Darkseer. So, I mean, he was being cute, but not effective, in my opinion.
Raven has had a mantle on the courier for a good 2 or 3 minutes now. His null has been done for ages. But the fact that mid lane is bottle crowing, they're bad and just sending it back and forth. Top lane had to have something delivered a little while back, I guess, Ring of Protection for this Beastmaster. The null is never going to be complete for Raven. Never. And I guess with the gold he's saving up, it could be a bottle that he's actually going to be bringing out to himself in a little while as well. Oh, Darkseer run away. He pulls the creep camp across, or creep wave across, and back into his zone with his Iron Shell now up to level 3. Still going to get his level, still going to get a nice amount of gold, but it's just the fact that TNC have this Abaddon that's closing in on level 6. They're going to have a Juggernaut level 6 soon as well. Their experience gain is amazing. Just look at them. They've got 4 heroes sitting at level 5. The AA is the only one that's missing out at all. He's level 4, but that's fine.
I guess Lina kind of realized that the lane is, like, super easy, so the Bane can kind of lane against Abaddon, and they're kind of, like, mirroring what TNC are doing.
We haven't really talked about top too much. How's Beastmaster doing up here?
I mean, he's doing okay. Like, he's almost even with the Darkseer in terms of levels, and I think he has a much harder lane. So, I mean, the Darkseer kind of, like, he even left the lane, and he's still ahead, so I think Darkseer could have played way greedier and put more pressure on the AA to not pull, and for Queen of Pain to miss more last hits.
Well, Raven, he goes for the treads. So there's no bottle up on him. Mana regen and HP regen.
They're gonna make a move on the Beastmaster. Gyro's level 6. I think.
You're right. Nightmare to cooldown. Oh, he takes the Nightmare off, though, and actually gets out of the cooldown. Now they're in a little bit of a tricky situation here as the Abaddon will walk in. No glimpse back, and Nando tries to stand and fight, but it's not good enough. The Abaddon pops his ultimate, and in comes Teehee. Glimpse back, but he's got the spin. Nando should drop here. That TP just a little bit too late.
He's level 6, but Omnislash is going to kill people.
Rain Sap. Oh, what? No. That's illegal.
That was the luckiest Omnislash I've ever seen.
Radiant's bottom tower is under
attack. It didn't
bounce
even once. It's like he, like, spammed right-click on the Disruptor and, like, he controlled the Omnislash.
I mean, you can control Omnislash a little bit, but that much is ridiculous. Three bounces and all three. The RNG. Looking over Teehee. Crazy stuff. Crazy guy. That's a good old fight. So they get first blood and an additional kill for themselves, killing off the Gyrocopter, stopping the push, stopping the farm. Just so many things are cured there. Like, TNC just put a halt to Execration's plans, basically, for the next 3 or 4 minutes.
Oh, my bottom, I think. They got the kill.
Looks like the Tier 1 tower did drop, though, with the excursion they made up the top. I guess...
How did the Darkseer push the tier 1? I mean, he left the lane for, like, almost 2 minutes steal EXP from Juggernaut.
I'm not sure. He's just that strong. Maybe there's no glyph. Oh, Teehee, the cooldown. The one hits him, and in comes the Lina. Ice Blast is going to land onto Bane, but they don't have any follow through for this. And Abaddon, LSA, there we go, lands, but his ultimate's up.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
That's naughty. Ultimate just in time. Gets rid of that LSA stun. Gets rid of the negative debuff. And now Bane. Oh, the Observer Ward right between Tier 1, Tier 2. And AU, I don't think you know about this. Bane comes in with a Nightmare. The teammate's coming in lucky. Oh, you're right. Laguna Blade will finish him off. And Shanks. Cold Feet's not going to proc and get him caught in there with Nando. Gyrocopter diving behind the Tier 1. Shanks wants to fight some more. This AA is a juicy target, but Sonic Wave should secure the kill. Lina will get taken out. And on the back end of things, Teehee, 5 seconds until Omni Slash is up. Phase boots already. So you can 100% disassemble Iron Talon, you said earlier.
At least when the patch first came out, yes.
Okay, we'll see if Teehee goes for it, because disassembling that into like a Battle Fury is going to be great for him. Well, Execration, Gyrocopter's got a good amount of net worth. So does this Juggernaut, Queen of Pain. Juggernaut actually just goes and overtakes.
The Beastmaster had like a lot of gold, like 1500 gold, so I was wondering if he was saving up for a Blink Dagger, but he did buy the Wizardry staff, so he is probably gonna go to Lina. I think he can. Juggernaut?
Oh man,
oh,
look at that.
He's
Only Slash Gyro, the spin to follow through as well, but Teehee, are you really gonna commit hard for this? Well, the stick charge is there, Teehee's actually surviving through it. They're not gonna be able to land a stun onto him, but the glimpse back into Kinetic Field will secure the death of Teehee's Juggernaut. And I don't know if that's worth it for the jug.
Oh, the Abaddon. He already popped his ult to get rid of the sleep.
Oh, I don't think they've got the damage. Level 4 shield is there. And shell back into Vac. But AU's quick on his feet with the bottle charge is up. Another shield is ready. They don't have the damage for it.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Bane. Bane's dead.
Oh yeah, you're right. Roar into scream.
Well, Bane went Soul Ring, which is kind of unusual.
Attack. That's an old school choice.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
I mean, like, it's almost the same price as Arcane Boots. I think Arcane Boots is nicer.
That was a good play. They saw TP coming in and drops the storm. Who have you glimpsed back here? Actually catching the Beastmaster, but yeah, the Lina's backed
annoying.
Up with no mana.
The Disruptor has so much money. He could like save a little more and go like Blink or Glimmer Cape or Ghost Scepter if he doesn't want to be bothered by the Juggernaut too much.
I mean, even with Banes nowadays, we very often see like Null Talisman level 1, then into Brown Boots, into Arcanes. Soul Ring is a super old school pickup. That was back when, you know, Brain Sap was incredibly expensive, especially the earlier levels of it. But, looks like Queen of Pain gonna go for the standard Aghanim's build for her. What about Teehee? Has he decided yet? Oh, Yasha. So he's got the Band of Elven skin. Let's try and build into that Yasha.
I don't think Teehee likes having people faster than him. Like, he wants to be the fastest hero in the game.
That's Blast just clipping onto the Gyro. Teehee, though, stunned and obliterated almost. The heal comes through from the Juggernaut. Gets the spin off now, and look at that Bane go. That's an amazing Sonic Wave across the bow. A couple of heroes, but Shanks got the ability to hide back behind these trees as the glimpse will send Raven's Quap back a little bit, but Omni Slash ready. Teehee, movement speed. All you need is a little bit more time, a little bit more space. Darkseid comes in with a mech and will save him. Teehee, the heal comes through. He's got Omni Slash now. Shanks is going to get shredded once, but it's not enough. The Juggernaut dies.
Did he not see the Lina cast the stun because of a tree or something?
I'm not sure. Either way, he got way too cocky with the Omni Slash ready.
But that was actually really. I thought AU would. Use his ult to get out of the sleep earlier, because he might have died there to the Fiend Grip. You know what's funny about this new patch is, like, whenever I take a look at the mid-tier one for Radiant, it looks like the tower's pushed, because, like, tower's so far back.
Yeah.
Like, I see, like Gyro and Lina on top, and then I have to scroll down to see, oh, the tower's still there.
Where's the tower gone? What's going on? It makes it so much more balanced, though, because that was like the biggest thing about the sort of entrances into this Dire mid, was that there's just so many ways in behind and in front of that tower. And the Radiant, there's no way. Oh, the glimpse back to Teehee. Caught again, an Execration. Actually running rampant through this. The past couple of kills they got are absolutely massive. Now AU, the damn Abaddon, gets caught by the first missile landing, and now looks like he might just drop us. Nando does have another Rocket Barrage. That and a Phonic Shield will keep alive a little bit longer, but not long enough. And a good Static Storm from RR. Right, Raven and Lucky are both caught inside the midst of this. And with the glimpse back, they won't get lucky. Ice Blast flying across, but it's not going to land. Very close to clipping, but 4 dead. Almost a full team wipe as the Gyro picks up a triple. An Execration. That's more than just getting your name up on the board. That's taking a firm grasp on this game.
A gift from the Tempest of Battle. I don't want to have like the "I told you so" attitude, but I feel like this is just like a. It really comes down to how much more control Execration have right now. Alina has a Yules now, so she can act as an initiation, and. The Bane and Disruptor are kind of like, they're the ones choosing when to fight. Whereas Sam H on the Beastmaster, he's been kind of focused on farming his Necrobook. So we saw him kind of join the fight late and still like not be able to be as effective. Because his team was like losing the fight because they have no control. AA doesn't do anything. Abaddon can soak damage, but he's being kited as we saw like. They just basically wait for Abaddon's ult to end, and then they drop the gyro call down, and he's not making the best use of his hero. So I hope TNC realizes what the problem is, and kind of like Sam H plays a more proactive role right now.
I wonder what the Abaddon's actually building into. He's got 1400 gold. Brown Boots Sage's Mask, he's not really shown his hand at all. You know, it could go straight into the Aghanim Scepter. But the offlane abandons we've seen recently, you know, during the summit there was that pub player. Logon booked his offlane abandon always. Goes for like phase boots, drums, Vlads, and into the Aghanim Scepter. I'm not seeing that here from AU. He could go for the Vlads with the Sage's Mask if he wants to. But equally, Dyer's could rush into that Aghanim Scepter. Attack. And really mess up with Execration's kind of damage output and thresholds that they're working with here. As Raven's Quap, yeah, lagging behind. Net worth sitting just below 6k. And might get even lower now as they go in with a Surge, Bane, Nightmare, Fiend's Grip. No, into the fog, and Queen of Pain gets away. They'll try the Vacuum, which is already long gone. Raven escapes.
Yeah, it was only a matter of like a few milliseconds. Like. The Quap was able to get into the trees before Bane could get the animation for Grip off. Well, that was quite unfortunate for Execration. Meanwhile, they're putting some good pressure at top because I guess Raven unintentionally created space at bottom.
Raven's
still down. They have a mech on Darkseer. I mean, the TNC does have the AA, but I think at this stage of the game, mech is still very powerful despite the AA. Like, the AA blast is not expected to land on all of your heroes. Maybe one or two key heroes, but yeah, the TNC is not gonna really bother with this. The towers are already been surrounded, and they're putting some good pressure on two lanes. And you see the mass DPs mid.
Oh, glimpse! There we go, but he can spin. Wanted the Abaddon or someone else, I think, there. And now they're going to be chasing down bottom lane. Lina. You've got Yules, you've got Stun, and that's why TNC are not going to be chasing there. The Roar was expended, actually. And the Sonic Wave. But they didn't kill.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
I didn't quite catch her. How did Lina survive that?
I have no idea. I was watching mid. But look at the cooldowns. Roar and Dire's Sonic Wave are both used on, I guess, the Lina. Dire's
top tower is under maybe attack. She might have Yules dodged it. I mean, she doesn't have enough HP to tank through it all. Like, I'm guessing one of the Queen of Pain spells got dodged by Yules.
I guess so. Dyer's top tower. Either way, she gets out.
He has level 2 Omnislash, but the Lina does have Yules up there, so.
Oh, there's the Yules used, so TE maybe can actually get back into this. He's not going to go for it till the AA dies.
The Disruptor has Glimmer Cape on top of the ult. So
oh, you're right.
It would have been very, it would have been very risky.
Oh, they killed the Darkseer with the Roar and the Laguna Blade. And the Sonic Wave, never mind. The Lina was just collateral damage and was running around afterwards. Poor little Darkseer. People get so angry. Well, Abaddon went for Midas. So no rushed Aghanims, no drums, no Vlads, no blade mail, nothing along those lines. Looks like TNC kind of aiming for the late game. As mid, TP comes in, Teehee. Oh, the Yules is ready. They're going to see him, but the Omni Slasher through. He uses himself, so the Lina not going to tank the damage now with the Cold Feet. The Glimmer Cape crit from Teehee. Perfect timing. Darkseer did not mech, you're right. And the Courier being hit down by these illusions. Oh, man. If only DS had used his mech there.
Oh, Beastmaster.
Fiend's Grip a little bit faster off the trigger than the Roar. But Sam H, he's got Necro 2. He's got Roar available back onto the Gyrocopter. Turns to fight. Sam H. Ditch. Die. But the Sonic Wave is big. Across 2 with a Scream as well. And that's well worth it. Killing off the Beastmaster, but losing your Gyro and your Bane, as well as the Lina a little bit earlier on. TNC, after the awful fight they had middle lane when Gyrocopter got a triple kill, now they have SNY on Jugger. They've got the Aghanims plus a nice amount of gold over on the Queen of Pain, but it's the AA. Arcanes, nearly Midas, and that Abaddon has a Midas with the Medallion done as well.
I don't think I've seen this build from Abaddon before, Midas Medallion. I kind of question the Medallion in this game because only 20 minutes into the game, majority of the damage coming from Execration is magic damage, and there aren't many right clickers yet. So I feel like he could have just gone like the drums, because Juggernaut, he skipped the drum, so they could have had a super fast team fight potential when they run in. I think that could have been really nice because they don't have as many control tools as Execration does.
Is Lucky ever going to get this Midas done? Because he had like 600-700 gold when he left top lane. Then he's like, right, I'll buy Smoke, I'll buy TP, I'll buy Observers. And he's just delaying the Midas little by little. I don't know if the Ancient Apparition will ever complete his dream. And it's already 22 minutes in.
At this point, it's really hard because Abaddon, which is, AU is usually his supporting duo. He's gone full core mode, so this AA should probably give up on the Midas and Bane instead.
We missed the kill on Juggernaut at top, which is kind of unfortunate. The bigger kill happened, but what did they actually use there? Static Storm? Yeah, Static Storm, as well as this Lina throwing Laguna Blade down. The trade is the Bane, but can TNC get Roshan here? They've got the Necro Books out with the double boars, and they're not going to go for it. Middle tower is under attack. Not enough damage, not enough time, as the Gyrocopter was, it's waiting in the wing. It's going to clear out the Ancients. It's not something you really want to walk into, is the Gyrocopter during the Roche Pit.
The top and mid lane was getting pressured way too much. I think they could have like just pressured both of the lanes, and Gyro could have dropped called out while they Roched, and that could have been the end of Roche, basically. Because they did use all their spells. AA didn't have much mana.
Radiant's top tower Shanks. Is under attack. What are you looking at? Aghanim Scepter's 400 away. It's tier 1 tower at bottom lane, though. Still a thorn in the side of TNC. They really want to take it out. But Raven hasn't had the chance. And this Queen of Pain is starting to lag behind a little bit in terms of actual item progression. Like, net worth, she's fine. It's just the fact that she's going Aghanim's BKB.
Execration smoked, other words. That's like the worst feeling when you smoke and then put the sentry in, find out that you got played.
Oh, you poor guys. Poor guys. Oh, they get another observer ward down at the very least, so a bit of vision over in the Radiant jungle. We'll give them some much-needed intel. But yeah, how do you feel about this Queen of Pain's build? So the slow build-up is like the Treads Null, Bottle Wand, then Aghanim Scepter, and then BKB. I guess she needs it for Disruptor ult?
I think ideally when you're a safe lane Queen of Pain, you want to go the most common build, which is Orchid BKB. But looking at the heroes on Execration, they have a lot of heroes like Queen of Pain, she can't afford to make too many mistakes, but with like a Bane and Disruptor and Lina with Yules running around, she's going to be really hard pressed to like not die for like a long period of time. So she went for the Ags, which is tankier, and I think she realized TNC kind of needed the earlier teamfight potential because the Beastmaster wasn't quite strong enough, and they between her, the Abaddon, Juggernaut, and AA, they don't really have the control, so they need to at least have the better AoE damage, maybe. Because even if you orchid someone, I don't think it doesn't change the fact that, like, you still have to chase her down, chase someone down, and like you need stuns. So she kind of like took a different approach where she'd be more available with the Ags.
More consistent damage when you group up as a team. Try and fight against Execration when they start to group up. So they smoke into the Roche bit here. It's the Roche on with the Santa hat, but I'm pretty sure Execration knows what's going on. Abaddon is very pushed forward here, posturing and making sure that there's no aggressive play from Nando.
Oh,
but
it's going to be a matter of seconds, I think.
It's going to be.
Execration is fast enough.
A tight one TNC. There's an illusion from the gyro in here. The cooldown is launched, but look at this. The roll back onto Bane. The Nightmare's there, but there's no Fiend's Grip with the Glimmer Cape. Ice Blast will be focused only onto the Bane. It just about hits, but the back back onto the wall. Up on the high ground. Static Storm's dropped a Raven. Trapped in the silence, dying to Laguna Blade, and the right click attacks. T. Was he up there as well? He bounced.
He
Omni Slash bounced up onto the high ground. That's the worst possible thing that could happen. And now Roshan's gonna go to Execration. They'll take it. AU trying to steal it, but he's stunned up. Gyro picks it up after killing off Roshan, and that's just devastating for TNC.
There were none. That was quite sad. At first, I thought it was going well for TNC because Abaddon was wasting like time on the hill, preventing the Execration heroes with the AoE wombo combo to come down and place their cooldown and disruptor hold. But I don't like the vacuum. I guess I forgot to mention, like, the Darkseer was really farmed this game, despite the slow early game start. I think that's the first time we see the Blink Vacuum in like a real actual team fight. And he, you know, the vacuum on the hill was kind of. I think that's one of the things I feel like should. Like, if you're gonna patch the Rubick and Magnus Skewer on the hill, I feel like that should be patched too. I don't know, but it's like. It's one of those things that they're sacred in Dota, maybe. It's been around forever, so.
Yeah, vac back onto a clifftop. It's just one of those things. But then you look around the rest of the map. How many cliffs are left that you can't walk off of? There's the one near the Radiant Secret Shop, sort of near the top rune spot. There's that cliff there you can vac onto. But everywhere else, they've added all these little areas where you can just walk off cliffs. You know, there's areas where there's gaps between the trees.
But I think they purposely leave it for Roche because, like, they want the games to be exciting and, like, people that usually, like, you resort to cliff vacuuming people when you're behind, and that leads to, like, Aegis steals and, like, team wipes that shouldn't happen, and, you know, it makes it exciting for the viewers, I suppose.
Indirect buff to Darkseer. Well, not a buff, but just keeping it the same so he's not nerfed. Allowing that rush pit to stay the same, keep the terrain the same. So, Gyro, what we're looking at? BKB Manta Helm. 1500 gold, again, a little bit limited on the damage, but he's got enough stats and survivability with the item set he's got to just keep himself pumping through.
Look at the wards from Execration's side there. I mean, they forced TNC to move as 5, I think, because, like, bottom tower is under attack. They can see which way TNC, so if they split up, they'll know exactly who's where, at least they'll know who's heading where, and they'll make optimal plays. I think TNC, they started pressuring top tower maybe a bit too late, so you already see, like, they barely got there and, like, they have to TP back, so this is kind of an awkward situation for them.
Tier 3's taking a pummeling. Are they not going to come back and defend it? Sonic Wave is there, but Bane? Bane tried to go for the Phoenix, but it's all too late. The Vac-back into the wall will catch three of them. BKB from Raven runs himself full, but the Ags upgrade Laguna Blade. Clears through that Queen of Pain, no problem whatsoever, really. Glimmer Cape keeps the Lina under wraps for now, and the Gyro with the Lina just back themselves up. They've chipped away at tier 3, and they stop the push up at top.
Radiance middle
a decent move there by Execration. His Ice Blast isn't going to land onto anyone either.
The Darkseer picked up a Ghost up there. I'm not sure if. I don't think Darkseer usually gets into a position where he gets Omni Slashed by Juggernaut. I've been wondering what T's planning to build with this Ultimate Orb. It might be a Scotty.
I think Scotty's like his item on Jug. SNY Scotty. Go into like an Abyssal Blade or something like that. Maybe an AC. He likes his AC actually. I could see that happening. Seeing as you've got like Blink Necro 3 on Beastmaster, the Queen of Pain is more likely to go cast a build like Shiva's Guard Hex. Something along those lines.
Yeah, TNC is playing still pretty blind, and the wards we mentioned for Execration are still there. Some of them, actually, two of them are expiring right now. So, I think TNC wants to. They don't see outside their tier one area. So, as soon as they figure out where Execration is, I think they want to split up, and they know. Like, the Execration is going to do this kind of play where they have another crack at it. They TNC doesn't have Glyph, and the tower tier 3 is pretty low at mid, so... Even without the Aegis, they should have a pretty realistic chance of getting Max.
They just got the BKB on the Lina as well, and again, this is one of those items that can just allow you to walk through a team fight unimpeded completely. Ice Blast with the Roar is there. Nando. Oh, they've killed off the Gyrocopter. Okay, there we go. Good start. Teehee on the side. He's going to get taken down. Right click. No. The Mist Coil, the heals are coming through. And now Shanks is the one that's caught. Left alone by the rest of his team. Just right click down by the rest of TNC. Yule Sept to save him for a second. But it's not going to be enough as Sam H tries to right click through the Bane. The rest of them will TP themselves out, knowing that without Roar, without anything else to stop them from TPing, it's just free. Way out. Execration there, they kind of felt invincible.
Yeah, I don't think they expected the AA ult or something. I don't think the AA ult mattered on the gyro kill. The gyro was, I think, way too, like, it was way too aggro.
Oh, this Ice Blast connects. Can they go and dive in for a kill? Looks like they'll try Sonic Wave. Scream from Quap. And Bane is on the sidelines for 40 seconds. Now Disruptor. Disruptor has an Aghanim Scepter. Storms up in 10 seconds, but there's no Glyph available. They have to go for the big Vacuum Wall play. There's the drop, but there's still no Disruptor ultimate. If they just waited a little bit longer, they could have got the combo with the cooldown there. It's just not going to do a damn thing. Sam H is glimpsed back, though. They get the Beastmaster at the very least. But imagine if that vac wall was 10 seconds later. If TNC stayed around for 10 seconds, it's difficult to judge, you know. There's that moment where we can go now. It's not going to be the full combo, but it's going to be enough to send them back.
I feel like the Disruptor items is it's only kind of complete. You get the full value out of the item when you have the Blink Dagger, though, because if Juggernaut, for example, gets a spin-off, the ult is basically... It's wasted, right? So you kind of want to, like... Dire's bottom tower. Like, the Yule setup with Lina is really nice, so Lina's going to be in a more aggressive position, but if Disruptor doesn't have mobility Dyer's items like the Flick Dagger. It's kind of hard to follow up on the Yules with the Ag's Thunderstorm, which prevents any kind of BKB or Blade Fury.
They're going to go for AU here. Looks like the Yules is first onto Jugger, and he's going to get stormed up with the Laguna Blade Vac back. They've got them all trapped in here. They don't have buyback on the Juggernaut, nor the Beastmaster. AA will return to the fight, but Raven blinks himself away, and AU nightmared up. No ulti remaining. And Queen of Pain didn't blink far enough away. Blink ready now, but too slow on the trigger. Tried to Sonic Wave.
They're going to try to kill the Lina, maybe.
Don't know if they can. Ice Blasters on the Gyro. They're spam pinging on him, but... This Queen of Pain, where are you now? Where are you? Sonic Wave across the three. Blink, scream. But this might be the end. Ancient Apparition dies, and I guess they've got a glimpse of a couple of seconds back from this Disruptor. They had it ready. Didn't throw it down onto the Quap, though.
top tower is under attack.
Thanks, Travelfall!
Oh, there's one melee racks down. AU. Nightmared up again. This Bane is just such an annoying hero to handle. And Raven waiting out his next ultimate. Maybe he just goes... I don't know. Do you wait for Juggernaut to respawn and then you go for the Omni slash Sonic Wave play? Because Juggernaut is going to respawn in 2 seconds time. But Execration, like, yeah, whatever. We'll bail. We'll run. We don't need to fight. We've just taken a lane of racks and a tier 3.
Yeah, I think Execration is pretty happy with that. Tier 3 is still a big... it's going to make the next push easier. Oh. Gyro's going for Scotty. He has a Venom Orb.
Well, Queen of Pain. Ags BKB in 3k gold. I'm still unsure about where she heads with this build.
Everyone's so tanky. I thought maybe if the Bane and like Disruptor were squishy, she could have maybe gone for the refresher. Because I don't think the Lina. Well, the Lina can. She has to save the ult for either the Juggernaut or the Queen of Pain. But with double BKB, it still will make her life easier.
Seeping back now. I'm a bit worried about what's going on and where Execration are going to be heading to. Scardy, Gyro, Lina, BKB, Ags, Yules. It's just a Juggernaut. Did go for the Scardy, tanks up, but his damage output's kind of limited. Hex on the Darkseer, and okay, there's the Greaves over on your Abaddon. Midas, Greaves, and that medallion. But take a look at Roshan. Both teams know he's up. Both teams really want to try and contest this and get into the pit.
Well, I don't think.
And yeah,
they
guys.
Actually
I guess so. With the Ice Blast coming in, they're going to try and contest this. Roshan's not going down fast enough. TNC, this could be your chance now to close out this game. Sam H is going to run in, but there's the Brainstep. Nightmare stops the roar. The cooldown onto three, and the backpack into the kinetic field. Static Storm, they're all trapped at TNC. They're all pretty much screwed. Two are dead already, with Omni Slash bouncing back for three of them all. Teehee is now left alone, Hex, and destroyed. Spin TP is just about going to be enough with the Greaves finally coming out of that Abaddon, but he gives up his life for it. 3-1, the Bane is the one that dies from Execration.
I mean, like, vacuum at the Ags Disruptor ult, GG. I felt like they were too rushed. I think they should bring the AA too. They need, like, it's not like the AA is useless at all. Like, I think they should have gone as 5 and been a little bit more patient. They were only like 1 Rax down. Just 1 melee Rax down. I'm not sure, like, that wasn't like their only play, I think. At least if it was, like, they could have executed it much better, but it said like they just ran in a straight line and they got 3 men vacuumed into Disruptor ult. It's like the, you don't expect like this, that kind of play to happen at this level, but I guess they were kind of panicking.
Well, there's one lane. Again, Melorax gone. Static Storm Kinetic Field dropped, but Teehee will just walk it off and spin away. Execration, have you got game number 2 in the bag? Drawing it up 1-1 with a roar. Maybe TNC can mount a last defense with the vision they've got over Shanks. They're going to get the BKB onto many turns and fight Laguna Blade with a Slave and LSA. You're going to get thrown out, and they're lucky. Ice Blast, a celebratory one, as he will die, and he's on the sidelines for about a minute. It looks like Execration just want to secure that Mega Creeps lane here as Beastmaster buys back. And the Hex starts things off. Juggernaut back into the wall. Now Teehee grips up. There's nothing to stop them. Sonic Wave is a good amount of damage, but it's just no control. Teehee gets himself out. And oh no! The Ghost Scepter from BYB. That Omni Slash doesn't do a bloody thing. Lina will finally drop, but Sam H, who's on the run out. AU Zabaddon, yeah, I'm not sure about this. Damage output nil. HP nil. Chances of survival, you guessed it, nil. Final lane of Axe here. Execration, they've got this one in the bag, I think. Raven, Queen of Pain, blink away, try to get out. Yep, up onto the high ground. The cooldown will get... got a bit of damage there, but there's no glimpse. Psychic Storm was still on cooldown. This Gyrocopter still has Aegis. He's just going to stand his ground. Static Storm is there. He doesn't care. The Disruptor basically solo kills two heroes with his ultimate.
I was wondering why the Gyro was completely ignoring the Juggernaut. It's not like he has a lot of items. They're not the most DPS oriented items, but he was like trying to kill the Ranger Axe with ignoring the Quap and the Jug, as if like he had like some kind of rapier.
There we have it, 1-1. Execration draw it up with TNC. And that leaves us with one series remaining. It's been close. This series was, like you said, it's the two Pinot teams. They know each other pretty well. It's just that
I'm assuming that actually, but
I'm pretty sure.
Yeah,
pretty sure they scrim against each other. Every like even in just SEA, a lot of the SEA sort of tier one teams. They all like to scream each other. They're all in my mind, they're all good friends. They all love each other. They're all friendly and nice. That's 1-1. Not a bad result for Execration. I'm not sure how that leaves us with the actual bracket though. Let's actually have a quick read. So IG 1-1 drew 1. CDEC have drawn 2. TNC have drawn 1. No, TNC have drawn 2 now. So that puts them on 2 points. So CDEC, TNC are on 2 points each. Invictus Gaming are on 4 points. And Execration are on 1 point. And with one... There's one series left, right? Well, one series for us and one series for the other stream.
Yes.
Okay. So this group is actually pretty open.
Yeah, I suppose that anything could happen right now. But, let's see. IG versus TNC... I think IG is like how many points do you okay? So two wins is 6 points, right? So anything above 6 points is really good because you play 3 games.
Yeah, but basically you look at it where like 4 points is like 4 points is middle of the table at least. So you're looking at sort of second place. 5 points is sort of you're basically through already. There's very little chance that you're gonna get toppled, and then 6 points is like yeah, pretty much automatic. You're good.
It looks like most of the teams, like they're pretty even. Like they all went to 2-0. I don't think any team can be counted out so far.
No,
I mean, Execration has to go 2-0. I think they only have 1 point.
Yeah, they have to get 3 points, and then they tie up with IG, but that's against CDEC. And then in that case, if they 2-0, they get 3 points. Then they need TNC to lose as well.
Yeah,
no,
if Execration 2-0 CDEC, that would be one of the biggest upsets. CDEC will be out. They only have 2 points on CDEC. So
oh, yeah, that's true.
Both teams really need to go 2-0 in that game.
Well, we'll have a little break. We'll be back with IG up against TNC in a little while. CDEC against Execration will be on the other stream on Join Dota Red. But myself and Heen will take a little break and be back with the final series of the night, IG against TNC, after a little break.